Hey boy! Let's do a little video on tweaking the fridge. Why are we going to do this? Well, the newer refrigerators, Energy Star refrigerators, they're designed to save energy. And the way they do that is they put a smaller compressor in them and makes them run longer. And actually saves energy by doing so. And unless you're, get away from me, fly. I'll eat you, fry you and eat you. Better go on. It depends on the climate where you're at and as to how long it's going to take your refrigerator to keep things cold. And home refrigerators aren't really designed to maintain a certain temperature and hold it. They kind of fluctuate. They fluctuate between a pretty wide zone. The older ones, they freeze everything in the refrigerator section if you turn them down enough. The newer ones, you crank it low as it'll go. By low as it's going to keep the food in there is maybe 35. Maybe more like 38, depending on how often you open it. And when it goes into defrost, which it's they're set up to do pretty often, some of them every 8 hours, some of them every 12 hours. When it goes into defrost, and if you open it, you lose 5 degrees right there, boom. Even if you grab my pop, shut it, boom, 5 degrees if it's in defrost. And it's not in its cooling cycle. Commercial refrigerators, walk-in coolers, that sort of thing, are more robust. They've got bigger compressors. They're made to recover quick. And you can actually tell the defrost timer, it's a smart one, you can actually tell it to go into defrost at night when the restaurant's closed and nobody's going to be opening the door. So and you can also really set it to what temperature you want, because you don't want to store certain types of foods above that danger zone, which is 40 degrees. So if you got yours cranked down all the way at 35 and you open the door a couple times, it's maybe up to 45 degrees at this point. And yeah, it's going to start recovering, providing it's not in that stupid defrost cycle, which it needs to have to de-ice the car. So, first thing you need to know is the refrigerator has an inside cooling coil, evaporator coil is what it's called. It's also got a condenser coil. Usually the condenser coils are located underneath, worst possible place in the world, because all the dust goes when you're sweeping the flow. Dust gets all up in the coil. You got to clean it. Best clean it about once a year, unless you like replacing your refrigerator every 5 years. But you can go 2 years, depending on how, if you live in a desert, you better clean it every year where it's real dusty outside. Just depends on your conditions. So let's take a look at a couple of my two refrigerators. One of them's older, it's not Energy Star, but it's a side-by-side. And my other refrigerator, the one that's in our pantry, is called the half and half, and it's really not half and half. It's got a bigger freezer section than most refrigerators do. Most refrigerators have got a smaller freezer section and a larger refrigerator section. Now that type poses a maintenance problem. I'm going to show you. Also, let me state that some refrigerators actually have a coil on the back side of it, and there's no fan. It's just convection. Radiation heat rises off of it. Those don't require cleaning but like every 10 years. But they're getting away from those because they're not as efficient as the forced fan condenser coil refrigerators. Let's take a look at this one, this side by side over here. Okay. Looking underneath the refrigerator, And I've got the little kick plate removed. And you can see that coil up in there. It's pretty clean because I just cleaned it. This type of coil is real hard to clean. You've actually got to get your vacuum cleaner's crevice tool up in here and then take one of these special brushes and stick it in there. Got to work it in and have your vacuum cleaner sucking right here by the brush. As you pull it out, dust is going to stick to the brush and come out with it. And you just got to keep working it top and bottom all the way across and get it clean. Okay, so you can do this one without removing the refrigerator from the damn house. This one, however, they don't have enough room to get to the coil underneath it because of its the way it's laid out on top. They using as much faceplate real estate as they can. So this refrigerator's actually got to come out of here. You take it outside and you blow it out with air, compressed air, or you can wash it, but you got to be real careful washing that, putting water on electronics that's underneath this refrigerator. Alright, the defrost timer has settings. Right here, there was a plug, and inside of there is a place to stick a screwdriver, and that cycles the defrost timer. Like if it's in defrost and you don't want it in defrost, you can stick your screwdriver in there and it only turns one way. You can hear it. It starts clicking. Click, 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 and it'll come on. Providing that the coil temperature is not too hot, because the way it defrosts is it's got a heating element in there. It looks kind of like an oven element, a bake element or something on that coil, and it warms up and melts the ice. And they got a little thermostat up in there that senses that this coil's too hot to let the compressor try to come on. It would send hot refrigerant down in the compressor, and they don't like that. So it's got some safeties on it. But you can click it out of defrost, and this was not in defrost right now, so I'm not going to disturb it because I don't want it to go into defrost, number one. And when it's in defrost, if it just went in and you heard it click off, because when you do this little tweak thing that I'm going to tell you, it ain't a shut off. It's going to run 24/7 and in and out of defrost. That's the only time the compressor and fans are going to shut off. This one runs continuously now that I've turned it down, because it's got a small compressor in it and it's trying to maintain this set temperature that I've got set. Now, where do we tweak that thermostat at, JB? I hope we don't fog the lens up looking in here. I've removed the temperature controller knob. Okay? Right in there at the very top. I know you can't see it. There's a little place to stick a screwdriver. Let me get a Perner. Okay. Got a little place to stick a screwdriver. Right up in the very tip top. You reach back up in there. Make it see it better. If I shine a light up in there, I don't know. But there's a small, small screw, and you're going to need a little micro screwdriver to get up in there. Put my knob back on. Ah. One more thing while we're on the subject. Read how your settings are. See, this one says freezer, initial setting C, coldest setting E. Look, I've got it on A because I want most of the air to come into the refrigerator section and keep it coldest. See, I've got this thermostat on almost cold as it'll go. Coldest is 9, so I've got it on about 7.5 right now. I'm going to tell you why. Coil that makes the cold air is in the freezer section, and the fan is in there, and they've got a little damper on that wheel that adjusts the freezer's temperature that it's like a air damper, like on the air conditioning in your car. You can make the air go up or down, or turn the air on and off with the other little switch. Well, that's what that one does. It controls the volume of air going into the refrigerator. Put it to the max. Make it blow the hardest. Don't worry about the freezer section. It gets cold. Get plenty damn cold. You better freeze shit in your refrigerator when you get done with this. So, on that little adjustment that I showed y'all behind that temperature knob, be real careful. Only turn it an eighth of a turn at a time. It is very, very sensitive. Try 1/8 counterclockwise. You'll have to have some kind of thermometer in there to check, see what you've done. Give it about 12 hours, check it, or the next day and check it. What I also recommend you do is get a plastic thing of water, half full, it don't matter, stick it in there. See how long it takes it to freeze. Now, the actual knob that you pull off and put back on, set it halfway to start with, because 1/8 of a turn is all that one needed. I don't remember whether I went counterclockwise or clockwise. It depends on who made that control. Was it Honeywell, Robert Shaw? Was it Japanese firm, Mitsubishi? You know, there's no telling. So it could go one way. You might turn it the wrong way, and it might actually get warmer. So only go an eighth. Put it back, go an eighth the opposite way, and see does it drop the temperature. Once you noticed, okay, it's dropped the temperature, now you take that knob that we pulled off and you make your final adjustment from there. Naturally, you already had it cranked cold as it would go, and it still wasn't cold enough. So roll it back to center position, halfway, like if it's 1 through 10, put it on 5, and make sure all the air is going into the refrigerator section, or as much as what can, on the freezer knob, usually a thumb wheel. Sometimes they're rotary too, but find out where that air is coming out at, and you can feel it when it's blowing hardest. Forgot what I was going to say. Let me get a pop. I know. Once you notice it's dropped in temperature, now you can start cranking that cold control down to colder. After I did mine, 7.5 of freeze pops. If you got them, it depends on where that air is coming out. So you put your warmest beer right where the airflow is, and you put your coldest beer away from the airflow. And normally, if you drink them fast enough, they won't have time to freeze. Be careful. Don't put no Cokes in there. I made that mistake. The kids put some Cokes in there. Next day, boom, Coke explosion. Had to take the whole damn thing out and wash it. You may too. So watch what you put in the refrigerator section after you make this adjustment, or you're going to have a freaking mess. Trust me, boy. I've been there, done that. That's why these newer fridges don't get as cold, is because of the energy efficiency. But you can tweak that setting, but keep in mind it's going to run all the time. While running all the time, it's going to get dustier more often. Have to make sure you keep it clean. So the first thing you got to do when before you make this adjustment is clean that condenser coil normally underneath. If you got a half and half like this one, you're going to have to get it outside unless you want to blow compressed air all up there. You really need to get to it, and you normally get to these from the back. You got to get them out, and you can see it's kind of cramped in there. Ain't no room to work. It'll come out, and it comes straight to you. Got to slide it sideways to get it out of the hole. But now you know. Good luck, my friend. If you burn your refrigerator up, I ain't liable. I ain't buy you a new one. You're on your own. Boy. One more thing. Most of these refrigerators are on casters where they'll roll straight to you looking at the door. Once you get it in place, they got some little feet that you can screw down on the front of it to make it lean back a little bit. That way when you open the door and walk away, the door will swing back by gravity because it's leaning back towards itself and it'll close. Make sure you get it set right so it don't stay open all night and all your shit be hot the next day. You can also reverse the doors on them. I had to reverse this one because it opened from the left-hand side. But in this little cabin, see if it would have hit. Can you see up there, boy? In here, in this tight spot, it would have hit over here on the hot water heaters right behind me over there. So it would have hit. And
one of the hot water heaters.
So you can reverse the doors on, and I did that on this one. All the hinges and everything changed. The handles go to the other side, and they got little plastic plugs you stick back in place. Now, all refrigerators other than side-by-sides like that one, you can reverse the door hinge opening the way the door was left or right-handed. You got all that Losh, Papa Tot,